Funding for this program was provided by Suzanne and Walter Scott Jr. and Gail and Michael Yanni.
Cross to the middle.
First time I saw Coach Osborne, actually after the game, was when I walked onto the bus and he said, "Nice catch, Matt." That was it.
Davison on the deflection. Nebraska's a point away.
Sorry, I can't give you more emotion or.
Hey!
That's the way I am.
Holy cow! Touchdown, Tommy Frazier!
Tom got up and talked to the team. And the first thing he said, you know, he said, "We don't have to win this game." And I'm thinking to myself, what am I doing here?
And the national championship is Nebraska.
Once branded as the coach who couldn't win the big ones, Nebraska's Tom Osborne has won more games in 25 years than any coach in college history. But for Osborne, it hasn't been easy.
The Husker eye back who pleaded no contest to the assault.
What a paradox. I mean, to have such an incredible football season and to have such turmoil, you know, bubbling around. His integrity, his character, being questioned, really, in a way, for the first time in such a national scale.
Often when his players were struggling, Osborne risked his reputation to help.
The one thing that separates Tom Osborne from many, many people is that he deeply, deeply cared. And you could see in his eyes.
Born in 1937 in the small town of Hastings, Nebraska, Tom Osborne's childhood was shaped by the work ethics of agriculture and athletics. His grandfather, Thomas C. Osborne, who would later become a minister, played football for Hastings College at the turn of the century. His father, Charles, played for the same school and so loved the sport that after he graduated, he kept a uniform in the trunk of his car, always ready for a game. But during the Depression, Charles had to travel the state 6 days a week as a salesman. When he was gone, he was deeply missed by his oldest son, Tom.
My dad, as usual, was, I think, sitting there reading a book or something. It came over the radio that the Japanese had bombed Pearl Harbor. And I remember him kind of jumping up out of the chair and saying something like, "By gum, I'm going to get into this thing." And he decided at that point that he was going to join the service. Really, the first 10 years of my life, my dad was around very, very little. I saw him on Sundays, basically, during the first 5 years, and then the second 5 years, he was gone totally. So when he did come back from the war and I was about 10 years old, I knew one thing that he really liked was athletics. I think in an effort to please him, I really redoubled my athletic efforts, and we played some catch with a baseball and football, and we had a basket out behind our house as I was growing up, and we had a light out there, and I remember being out there shooting baskets till 9, 10 o'clock at night, even when it was below freezing. And so I liked athletics. But I think there was a very strong need to gain my dad's approval. And it was really from him that I caught my enthusiasm for football.
Osborne played whatever sport was in season. He even helped organize a Presbyterian basketball team. In the sixth grade, they won the YMCA state title. By the ninth grade, he was one of the tallest boys in his class. And in baseball, He was one of the youngest players to make the American Legion team.
Well, I think on that baseball team, most everybody had a nickname, and usually they went for your weakness. I mean, you know, it wasn't a kind nickname. It was usually something that was kind of had a little sting to it, and they called me Yak at one point because they thought I talked too much, and that was the first time I'd really encountered that, and I really didn't know how to handle it very well, and you know, and I wasn't real good at laughing things off or just shrugging my shoulders. I tended to take things pretty personally. So it was a time when I think I withdrew a little bit. I decided, well, I'm not going to leave myself vulnerable to these guys. I'm not going to express myself anymore. And so I just kind of shut up. And I worked hard, and I became, I think, a fairly angry person. And I used that anger to get better. And so I was a fairly driven guy as an athlete. I had to be the best, or at least had to feel I was making a great effort.
Osborn made a great effort in athletics and academics. At Hastings High School, he lettered in three sports, playing quarterback in football. He passed up a football scholarship to the University of Nebraska to play where his father and grandfather played, Hastings College, just down the street from his home. He was drafted by the San Francisco 49ers, but quit training camp to attend seminary and studied to become a minister like his grandfather. But after a week in seminary, he missed football too much and rejoined the 49ers. He later played for the Washington Redskins, where he became their second leading receiver. After an injury, he decided to quit professional football and go home to graduate school at the University of Nebraska. But in 1962, Osborne's interests weren't limited to football and academics. One evening, he met Nancy Tiedemann.
We were on a double date, and he was with somebody else, and I was with somebody else. And I just didn't like him at all. He was so cocky and sure of himself.
And she didn't know much about me, and I don't think my being a professional football player really particularly served me well, because she was a little suspicious of that.
There was also a part of him that was intriguing, because he just didn't go along with what everybody said. He was going to let people know about it, and I liked that.
And I didn't feel that she was overly impressed with me, and I found that attractive to some degree. I mean, she had some plans for her life, and I wasn't necessarily part of it.
The second day, he told me they intended to marry me. So, I mean, that's pretty flattering. And that's kind of the way he operates, isn't it? Very decisive.
And we're married in August of that year of 1962.
Osborne intended to become a college professor, but when he got his doctorate in educational psychology in 1965, he found he couldn't leave football. He became an assistant to Nebraska's popular coach, Bob Devaney. In the previous 4 years, Devaney took Nebraska's losing program and turned it into a contender for national championships.
Like Frank Solich, first soft tackle.
But in 1967 and 68, Devaney struggled with only 6 wins each season.
Kansas State was a nightmare. From the weather,
he started turning over more of the offensive coaching to Osborne. Osborne designed a new option offense with an emphasis on the pass. The quarterback could run or pitch, but it was the passing option that made Nebraska dynamic.
It was just a spread formation. We had two receivers on both sides of the ball, and we had one back in the backfield. Today, I mean, people call that the run and shoot. We really kind of made the defense play the entire field, and that really opened up a lot. Tom Osborne was considered the passing guru of college football back there in 1970 and 71. Everybody mimicked and copied him.
Osborne and Devaney's new offense was in full force by the end of the 1970 season. Nebraska won 11 games and tied one and played for the national championship, the 1971 Orange Bowl against LSU.
It's Gary Taggy calling signals after a 67-yard march. And on a quarterback keeper, he dives for the goal line, making sure his plunge is across the goal line. Coach Bob Devaney's unbeaten Nebraska Cornhuskers are number one, 1970 National Collegiate Football Champions of America, and perhaps the greatest page in Orange Bowl history.
I remember Nancy and everybody wanted to celebrate, and I was a little bit tired, and I was a little disappointed in the way we'd played offensively.
These guys had worked so hard to get to this. And Tom was sitting up in our room and just, you know, like he was depressed or something. And I thought, what is the matter with this man?
And you kind of wonder, well, is this all there is to it? And I think it was really after that particular game that I began to realize that the process was probably more important than the end result, and that the enjoyment, the things that happened along the way, the road to getting to the national championship, in many ways was more meaningful than the trophy and the celebration and all the things that people attach so much significance to.
And so I ended up riding up down on the elevator, and of course it was packed with people that were Nebraska fans, but the reason I did that was because you couldn't get off. Once you got down, the lobby was so packed, I mean, there was just nowhere to go. So I just rode up and down and had a good time with whoever was on the elevator. Tom sat in the room.
Here's Wiley's kick. It's high. It holds up there. Rodgers takes
In 1971, the season came down to a single game. Number two-ranked Oklahoma against number one-ranked Nebraska in what has been billed by sports writers as the game of the century.
And again, you know, we felt like, you know, we had an outstanding defensive team. We didn't feel like anybody was going to score more than 30 points on us, but Nebraska did.
Kenny over left side, touchdown!
We weren't a good defensive football team. We made a lot of mistakes. Our ends weren't very smart. We allowed Taggy to run. Taggy isn't a great option runner, and Taggy had a big run in that ball game for busted assignment of a defensive end. It was a game that if we had been better defensively, we probably would have won, but we weren't good enough.
I think this here means more to us now than winning the Orange Bowl last year when we're national champions then, because we feel we're national champions right now. Right now. And ain't nobody stopping us. This year, next year either.
After they beat Oklahoma, Nebraska was ranked number one and would play for the national championship against Bear Bryant's number two-ranked Alabama Crimson Tide.
Observe closely, as you will see the biggest play in this ball game. The Tide's punt by God is received by Johnny Rodgers at the Nebraska 23. Rodgers, dipsy-doodle, faking and speed is too much for Alabama.
Despite Nebraska's success on the field, an off-the-field problem would soon bring Osborne and Devaney into disagreement. It was revealed that Johnny Rodgers had participated in a gas station robbery.
Well, when I got in trouble, Tom was the first one down there to see me and to take care of me. And he got me my lawyer and gave me directions and things to do. He was there first on the scene for me as well.
And Tom more or less took over. He did most of the work with the lawyers and everything else. And Tom worked Johnny. He did. And I'll say this for John Rodgers, you never had a guy in the football field working any harder than Johnny. He might find an excuse not to get there, but once he got there, he worked. He did. And Tom worked him.
And at times, you know, when you're young, it's clear that you really figure that you really know it all. And that's the time you really don't know anything. You know, that's probably your most vulnerable and your most dumbest times, when you're probably about 16, 17, 18, 19 years old. But that's the time you are sure you know everything there is to know.
Rogers was given probation by the courts and not dismissed from school. Devaney felt that since the incident was over a year in the past, Rogers should be able to play. Osborne didn't see it that way.
Bob and I agreed on most everything. I think at that point, my feeling was it might be best that John sit the year, and Bob thought he ought to go ahead and play, and he did play. But that was kind of the way Bob was with players, and he tended to be pretty understanding, pretty forgiving.
Tom helped me significantly. I mean, he and I were close before then, but I guess we got closer after that time, and he took an interest in me more so than he had before. Devaney was more like a father figure to me, and Tom's been more like a brother.
In 1972, Devaney announced he would retire at the end of the season. He surprised more than a few when he also indicated that his youngest assistant, Tom Osborne, would be his successor. In Devaney's final season, Nebraska won 9 games. Rich Glover won the Outland Trophy, and Johnny Rogers became the first Cornhusker to win the coveted Heisman Trophy. The stage was finally set for Tom Osborne to become head coach. But the transition wouldn't be easy. At age 35, Tom Osborne's head coaching career got off to a fast start, beating top 10 ranked UCLA. Against Wisconsin, quarterback David Hum passed for a school record 297 yards, completing 25 of 36 passes. For the third consecutive year, Nebraska was leading the Big 8 Conference in passing. But as always, one of the most important games of the season was against Nebraska's arch rival, the Oklahoma Sooners. Devaney, despite all his success, had a losing record against Oklahoma. Inescapably, Osborne would be judged by Nebraska fans based on how well his teams played against Oklahoma.
A 27-0 loss was the first shutout for the Cornhuskers in 58 games since the last game of the 1968 season.
We went down to Norman that year and we lost 27-0. And I don't believe we crossed the 50-yard line. And I was really hurt and stung by the by that defeat. They took it to us pretty good. There was no doubt as to who had the better team. And so the only way I knew to respond was to work harder.
Let's go! Let's take that ball, put it in the end zone. Let's go!
For the next 7 years, Osborne tried to work harder, but the Cornhuskers only beat Oklahoma once. Despite winning 9 or more games each year, Osborne knew if he was going to keep his job in Nebraska, he would have to find a way to beat Oklahoma. He decided once again to change Nebraska's offense.
The bottom line, as years went by, that a heavy emphasis on the passing game wasn't going to get us where we needed to go.
Osborne started taking a long, hard look at Oklahoma's triple option offense, where the quarterback could pitch, pass, or most importantly, run. But the secret to making the triple option explosive was recruiting outstanding quarterbacks.
When I got recruited by Nebraska, I didn't know a whole lot about it. Nebraska, period. All I knew about Nebraska was when they played Oklahoma. I mean, that was it. Because I grew up really saying that if Oklahoma offered me a scholarship, that's where I was going to go.
In 1979, one of the most sought-after recruits in Texas was a fast option quarterback out of Fort Worth named Turner Gill. Gill was personally recruited by both Switzer and Osborne. but the two coaches had very different recruiting styles.
Yeah, I wasn't in there to open a book and talk about things really important, academics and facilities and these things. I was more into the human interest and the player and them, their background.
You would think that, hey, he really relates to young people well, and you can feel comfortable around him, per se, and he's loose, and you can somewhat do some of the things you do at 18, 19, 20 years old, or 17, or whatever, and you feel comfortable around him. And I did. There's no question about that.
The combination of Switzer and Oklahoma seemed an ideal match for Gill. Switzer had started recruiting the best black athletes in the South when many Southern teams were still all white. His recruiting helped Oklahoma win national championships in 74 and 75.
And I think my background preceded me a lot of times. I think, especially in the black community knew my relationship with black athletes and knew that that I was playing black quarterbacks before anyone else was.
There was, I think, some doubts put in his head about whether we would play him at quarterback. You know, whether we would play a minority, an African American, at quarterback. And of course, Oklahoma had a number, and I was telling him that makes no difference to me. You know, I want to play the best player.
And I got that word from Coach Osborne. That's all I needed. I trusted him. I really liked his personality. It fit me with the way I was as a person and my personality, and I felt that he could help me reach all my potential as a student and as an athlete.
I should have spent the last 2 days with him like I did with the Billy Sims and the Kenny Kings and the Thomas Lotts, but I took Turner for granted.
Nebraska started the 1981 season with 2 wins and 2 losses. In the 5th game of the season, Turner Gill started at quarterback. For the next 3 years when Gill started, Nebraska would lose only 2 games. By 1983, they were averaging over 50 points a game. The Cornhuskers were nicknamed the Scoring Explosion. At the end of the season, they once again face their arch-rival Oklahoma, Big 8 Conference Championship. At the end of the game, with only seconds left, the Huskers were clinging to a 7-point lead. Neil Harris tipped away an Oklahoma pass in the end zone. Nebraska won their 3rd straight victory over the Sooners. The stage was set for Nebraska to play Miami in the Orange Bowl for the national championship. Miami led most of the game until Nebraska made a touchdown late in the 4th quarter to draw within 1. The score was Miami 31, Nebraska 30. Since Nebraska was undefeated and Miami had lost a game, Osborne could win the national championship simply by kicking an extra point and tying the score.
I did not sit there and consciously debate, do we go for the tie or do we go for the win? I just assumed that if you're going to win a national championship and in that setting, that you went for the win.
He's going to go for 2. Down the line, Turner Gill throws into the end zone. Jeff Smith, no good. It bounced off his chest.
Really, in a sense, was playing for us, but also trying to make sure that we get a national championship for Coach Osborne. I guess was kind of, in a sense, maybe I let him down or we let him down in a sense, but I know that I gave it my all. And again, I know that Coach Osborne, that's all he ever said was, all he wants to do is give 100% effort on every single play. He never did, in a sense, talk about winning the game. He talked about what we can control, which we can control our effort. And so that's all I did.
And afterwards, it was like, what's the big deal? I mean, he just couldn't understand what all the fuss was about, you know. And then to get criticized for it just blew his mind, because he's, to him, just to be a competitor, you go for the win. You know, you don't go for a tie. And I think that tells a lot about who he is. I really do. And I'm very proud of that. I agree with him. I think that's the way it should be done.
And I took a lot of satisfaction in the fact that we were good enough to win it. But that wasn't really good enough for some of our fans. I mean, they want the whole ball of wax. And but we won 24 games in those 2 years and lost two. And other than just the recent years, those were probably the best years that I had as a coach.
In 1984, Osborne's father, Charles, died of a heart attack. His mother, Irma, was in a nursing home after suffering a stroke. The next year, at age 48, Osborne himself had heart bypass surgery.
As I think back, I don't believe that in 23 years that I have missed a single day at work because of illness. And I think that I've tended to regard myself as a little bit of an indestructible person, which is not right, and that's probably why I'm where I am today.
The surgery was successful, but by the early 90s, doctors again detected problems with Osborne's heart. He could still coach, but he realized if he was going to lead Nebraska to a national championship, time was short. On the field, Osborne's teams were winning 9 or more games a season. But in the late 80s and early 90s, Nebraska lost 7 straight bowl games.
He was unhappy. I wouldn't say he was angry or mad, but he was unhappy. I mean, he pushed the coaches harder, we're going to recruit more, we're going to work harder. He changed everything.
Osborne once again decided not only to work harder, he decided to change Nebraska's basic strategy. Only this time, it wouldn't be the offense.
And I think a lot of the people in Nebraska felt that if we would just throw the ball like Miami, that then we would beat Miami or win like Miami did. And my feeling was always, well, if we could play defense like Miami played defense, it wouldn't make a whole lot of difference whether we were running the ball or throwing the ball. We would probably win.
Nebraska was running a 5-2 defense that relied on size. Florida teams like Miami and Florida State were running a 4-3 attacking style of defense that emphasized speed. Osborne and defensive coordinator Charlie McBride decided for the 1993 season, the attacking style 4-3 would be their basic defense.
Rush guys got him. They got him. Trev Alberts on the sack.
My goodness. We started shutting people out. I mean, we had so much speed on the field that when they ran the ball, we were just... I mean, we just attacked them. You know, you didn't sit there and wait. You just got up the field and made things happen.
Nebraska finished the regular season undefeated and faced number 1 ranked Florida State in the Orange Bowl for the national championship.
Ward rolls left, looks right. He's in trouble. He'll lose one man, and now is hit by the pursuit. Super play defensively by Nebraska.
The Cornhuskers lost by 2 points when their last second field goal attempt went wide.
We won that game, but I don't know if we should have won it. If you base everything, sometimes the team that plays best don't win, as you know. And that was probably a case that day. They played better than we did, but we won the ball game.
So as we walked off the field, we'd lost the national championship again, like we did in 82 and like we did in 83. But I still felt very good about the effort. I felt very good about the way we had played. The only concern I had was where the players would go from there.
In In 1994, Nebraska's team motto was Unfinished Business. On offense, Tommy Frazier was more experienced at running Osborne's option. On defense, the players were attacking with the new 4-3.
Strike wants to throw the ball, rushes on, and he is thrown under back at the 15-yard line.
By the end of the season, Nebraska was undefeated and would once again face a Florida team in the Orange Bowl for the national championship. This time, it would be the Miami Hurricanes.
Nebraska gunning for its first national championship since New Year's Night, 1972.
Making history tonight, baby, making history.
I'll tell you what, if you're a red-blooded Nebraskan kid, you didn't need much to get you fired up for that game. You're playing Miami in Miami for the national championship.
Miami had won 62 of their last 63 home games in Orange Bowl Stadium. By the third quarter, the Hurricanes took a 17-7 lead.
Inside the 10, inside the 5, and in there for the touchdown. Touchdown, Miami.
I mean, I think in the back of everybody's mind, everybody was wondering, oh, no. Here it goes again. I mean, the dang Florida teams are running right down the field on us. And, you know, maybe we can't stop them. Maybe we're not as good a team. And there was a little doubt there.
But then, slowly but surely, Nebraska started to wear Miami down.
Up in the backfield, they're going to get it for safety. Safety, Dwayne Harris, all over Frank Costa. The Huskers get a deuce.
Every time there was a TV timeout or the ball was blown dead on the field, all the Miami guys were down on their knees. They had their helmets off. I mean, they were spent.
And Tommy, on an option play, keeps the ball. He cuts it inside the 45-yard line, inside the 40. Tommy, inside the 35, inside the 30-yard line. Tommy Frazier to the 32-yard line. First and 10, Huskers. Schlesinger and Phillips in the eye, the snap to Tommy, and they give him the trap play, and it's Schlesinger inside the 5, and down for the touchdown! He's got the touchdown! It's the touchdown for Corey Schlesinger!
I mean, it was just like a monkey'd been lifted off our back. You know, everybody knew that we'd done it. We'd beat Miami in Miami, and we'd won Coach Osborne's first national championship in 20-some years.
And Nebraska enters history, 13-0, and bring that trophy back to Lincoln.
Naturally, it was a great sense of relief in the locker room to have finally worked that hard and to get there, as opposed to coming up close like we had the year before. But I think the team had grown very close over the course of the season because they'd been through a lot together. They'd had a very strong common commitment. And so it was kind of a unique experience.
Nebraska's goal in 1995 was to win back-to-back national championships.
Sherman wants to throw, goes for the home run, Lance Brown, touchdown! Touchdown, Lance Brown!
On the field, they were playing some of the best football in Nebraska's history. But off the field, problems began to mount. It was later discovered that the accusations against several of the players were unfounded. But there was one incident that made headlines across the country.
This is where the alleged assault took place. Redshirt quarterback Scott Frost lives in these apartments in Northwest Lincoln. Police say that Lawrence Phillips showed up here early Sunday morning. Phillips' ex-girlphand was reportedly here with Frost.
Phillips is accused of going inside Frost's apartment and assaulting Kate McGowan, a 20-year-old sophomore guard on the Husker women's basketball team. Police say Phillips pulled...
Osborne immediately dismissed Phillips from the team.
Obviously, we've lost a great player in Lawrence Phillips.
Eventually, Phillips was charged with two misdemeanors, trespass and assault. Osborne, like many head coaches, still felt a responsibility to the player he had recruited.
Every time I have a player gets in trouble, I get all these letters about, kick him off the team, he embarrasses us. I write them back. I say, well, now if this was your son, would you want me to kick him off? Or do you want me to try to straighten him out?
Osborne still felt a need to help Phillips, who had come from a difficult background in Los Angeles.
He lived in a group home, and most people who lived in a group home had been put there for legal problems, and that was not the case with Lawrence. It was a case of his not having a home. He was basically homeless for a year and kind of wandered the streets of L.A., and so we really had no red flags about Lawrence other than that he had had a very unstable home life and had been on his own since he was about 11 or 12 years old.
I come up with a one-parent family, basically, so I have my problems. Lawrence came up with no-parent family. I mean, he was basically just in an agency or something for a long period of time. The psychological baggage that he might be carrying, not having been in that situation, we really don't know.
Osborne identified with players who had difficult childhoods. He remembered his own father being gone during the Depression and World War II.
It wasn't like an inner city childhood, but I can relate to a lot of kids who have grown up in situations that are pretty unstable in terms of family. I think the one difference is that if your dad takes off on you and doesn't even care enough to stick around, you know, that leaves a hole in your self-esteem that's pretty hard to repair.
The Husker I-back has nothing to say as he leaves court after being sentenced to probation.
Phillips pled no contest to two misdemeanors and was given probation by the courts. The university cleared Phillips to return to football. In the end, Osborne alone would have to decide if Phillips would ever have a chance to play again.
I looked at him, and it's a moment I'll never forget. I looked at him and I said, Coach, don't do it. Don't do it. Make it a permanent suspension because we are going to have so much criticism. You will have picketing. You will have all kinds of people saying bad things about you. I just kind of knew. And I'll never forget as long as I live. He looked at me, and he got those two jugulars, and he got a little red in the face, and he said, I don't care. I can't do it to that young man.
Osborne decided to give Phillips a chance. He placed him on indefinite suspension. If Phillips did everything that was asked by the university, the courts, and Osborne, he might have a chance to play again sometime that season.
I know that what I did was wrong. I never tried to deny it or whatever. I've been a counselor to try to take care of the problem. I know there is a problem. I haven't tried to deny nothing that I did. I owned up. I went to court. And, you know, and it's just a guy who made a mistake, who reacted without thinking.
I felt the best thing we could do was to try to have Lawrence look at his situation, get counseling, and hopefully turn a guy out of the University of Nebraska that was prepared to deal with life a little more effectively than what he had.
Ironically, as Osborne's off-the-field problems mounted, on the field, the 1995 Cornhuskers were becoming one of the most successful teams in college football history.
I mean, it was the most dominant college football season maybe in the history of college football. What a paradox. I mean, to have such an incredible football season and to have such turmoil, you know, bubbling around. Not just personal turmoil, but I mean public stuff. I mean, stuff that people were criticizing him about that had been very important to him, his integrity, his character, being questioned, really, in a way, for the first time at such a national scale.
And my spiritual life was, frankly, the anchor that held me in there through that year. There's no question that spent a fair amount of time figuratively on my knees, I guess, that year.
Our behavior up to that point was like a whole bunch of boys. And we're in a society where we need to start acting like men. And we're at a big-time university. We can't be acting like boys out here having fun. We have to act like men who wants to be respected in the world. And that's the way we started acting. And the more we made a conscious effort to doing that, the better our team got.
Tommy throws the ball down the right side. Pressure Johnson. It's complete inside the 25, the 20, the 15, the 10, the 5. It's a touchdown! 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 Touchdown!
Nebraska finished the season undefeated and would play Florida for the national championship in the Fiesta Bowl.
From Sun Devil Stadium in Tempe, Arizona, this is college football's national championship.
At the end of the season, Lawrence Phillips had seen limited playing time. At the Fiesta Bowl, Osborn decided Phillips had met all the requirements of his probation. Phillips would start the game.
And you wide slot right, Tommy, gives to Lawrence, cuts back right inside the 40, great move, eludes a tackler inside the 35, inside the 30, the 25, the 20, 15, the 10, the 5, he's in there! Touchdown, Lawrence Phillips! Touchdown!
I think we could have won with the other running backs that we had. But I also think he didn't use Lawrence because he needed the win, but he used Lawrence because Lawrence needed to be used. He needed to be part of something again, and him sitting on the bench wasn't helping at all.
One back behind Werfel, three wideouts left, tight end right, Werfel, two-step drop, pocket holds, throws it left side, and it's picked off by Booker at the 30, the 25, to the 20, the 15, the 10, the 5.
By the third quarter, if there was any doubt about the outcome of the game, it was erased by quarterback Tommy Frazier.
And an option to the right, Tommy on the keep, turns the corner, 25-30. Eludes a tackler, 35. Tommy Frazier, 37, 38, 39, 40, 45, 50.
Championship for the second year in a row. The Cornhuskers have made football history. You can put it in the bank. It's over.
The most powerful time I can remember was right after the 95. We just won the Fiesta Bowl, perhaps the greatest team in 30 years. Coaches would be jumping up and down, shaking their fists, high-fiving. He sits down, has a prayer, kneels down with the whole team, stands up, and says, I just want to say something to you guys. If there's ever anything I can do for you, you let me know. I'll always be there. I'll always remember you. And I told you I want to thank you for everything you've done for this program. And I'll always be there to support you. I'm thinking, he just won a national championship. And look what he's saying to players. Then he says, and the rest of you players are going to have to get back to work pretty soon. I'm thinking, we just won. Take a night off. You know, chill out.
In Nebraska's victory, Lawrence Phillips rushed for 165 yards and two touchdowns. Tom Osborne knew that he would continue to be criticized for playing Phillips.
Anyway, the storyline is out, and I was portrayed, I guess, as a win-at-all-costs coach, somebody who would sacrifice principle for victories. But again, you have to do what you think you got to do. And I guess in some quarters, I'll always be known as the guy that played Lawrence Phillips. But that's so be it. You know, that's the way it is.
In 1996, Nebraska won 11 and lost 2. To many Nebraska fans who had grown accustomed to undefeated seasons, it seemed like a bad year. In 1997, while the team was grinding through two-a-day practices in the August heat, one of Osborne's past players was preparing to get a degree, a degree he had begun working on 30 years before.
And Tom said that he would support me in that endeavor if I would come back and I would do well. So I thought it would really be good to lead by example. And that's some of the things I got from Tom. And his best, you know, attribute, I think, is that he does practice what he preaches and he leads by example.
I think Johnny has come out at the end in good shape. He has stayed by his children, and I've always admired that. He saw to it that they had what they needed. He gave them support. He educated them. So many people today abandoned their families, and Johnny did not do that, and it would have been easy for him to do so. So there's a lot of the right things in Johnny Rogers.
Hey! Come on!
While Osborne was still intense in 97, players and coaches noticed in recent years that Osborne seemed to be having more fun. Osborne was not only having more fun, he was getting luckier. Against Missouri, Osborne needed all the luck he could get.
Frost to the middle, juggle, diving touchdown, Nebraska!
First time I saw Coach Osborne, actually after the game, was when I walked onto the bus to go to the airport. He was sitting there in his seat, and I walked past, and he said, "Nice catch, Matt." That was it.
Nebraska finished the season undefeated and ranked number 2. Just as the team was beginning to prepare for the Orange Bowl, Tom Osborne, after 25 years as head coach, announced his retirement.
I think it's important in this business to walk away while you can still walk and while you can still function and perform. And I feel that I can at this point. My family has been very supportive. And I think it paid a pretty good price for me being allowed to do what I've done. And the thing that I've enjoyed about coaching is the players and the coaches. And I will miss that very much. Those are the people that I care a great deal about.
And sitting back there when Coach Osborne was saying that he really didn't get a chance to see his kids grow up that much, I just wanted to say that he's had a chance to watch 150 guys on this team grow up and the thousands that came before us that he's coached grow up, and he's been like a father figure to all of us.
We don't just learn football around here. We learn how to be grown-ups, how to mature, and how to become men. And that's the thing that he's taught me the most, and I'd like to thank you for that. And we're just going to do our best to go down to the Orange Bowl and make sure that he goes out a winner and goes out a champion. So thanks, Coach.
Thank you.
As the Orange Bowl game arrives, number 2 ranked Nebraska is a long shot for the national championship. Number 1 ranked Michigan won the night before, but by only a slim margin. To win the national championship tonight, Nebraska not only has to beat number 3 ranked Tennessee, they have to do it decisively.
Your emotions on the day, knowing this is the last one after so many years as a football coach, what do they feel like?
I feel about the same as I always do. You know, you're a little bit nervous, but more anticipation, and so it's going to be a lot of fun.
Did you take note of anything like this is the last bus ride, this is the last time to walk with the players?
I didn't even think about that, but now that you mention it, I guess it was.
Thank you, Coach.
Okay.
Let's take these next 3 hours, and let's dedicate it to one of the greatest football coaches, if not the greatest coach there ever was. Okay? Let's do that. And to you seniors, okay, God love you. You did everything that we've ever asked. I love you all of you.
and I just want you to play your guts out and have some fun, okay? Okay, take a knee.
Day by day!
Day by day!
We get better and better!
We get better and better!
The team of KPB!
The team of KPB!
As the game begins, Tennessee's defense crowds the line of scrimmage to stop the run.
Under center, hands the ball off to Amon Green, and nothing to it. Tennessee's
Osborn decides to pass.
Paul, deep fakes, he rolls to the right, fires a pass at the field to Sheldon Jackson, who's got it! Across the 50, and Jackson takes it down to the 48-yard line. In the eye. Here's the option left side, now Frost looking, fires a pass, got Newcomb out there, he makes the grab, and he's spun down to the 14-yard line of Tennessee, and the Huskers are rolling it
up front, the handoff to Amon Green, he dives into the end zone, and takes it in for the score.
And it's a keeper by Scott Frost, he dives in for the touchdown.
After Scott Frost's score, Tennessee answers with a touchdown of their own.
Cocks the arm, wants to throw, and fires into the end zone, and it is a touchdown.
Tom Osborn tells his defense they will have to play tougher if they want a national championship.
Let's get after these guys. That was ridiculous last time. Let's go. Don't let them run that ball down your throat. Now let's go. Let's go.
The 11 guys that were there on defense, our eyes were just, you know, I mean, just wired.
This is an old-fashioned behind-the-woodshed beating. I don't think you have to look at too many fancy stats or go into in-depth analysis to see what's happening here. They simply wore them down and then physically beat them up, and can't say I'm surprised.
Well, as my friend Chris Fowler says, Chris Fowler says that it's going to be an old woodshed. Take them out behind the woodshed. Spank them.
Go, Mike. Go, baby. Go, baby.
Each to the 20, each to the 15, 10, 5. Look out. He's gone. Touchdown.
You know, I don't know if he was going to be mad or not. And he turned around, and he looked right at me, and he started laughing. And then that's when I just went up, and I just gave him a big hug, and I was just like, thanks. You know, thanks for everything that you've done for me over the past 5 years.
The Huskers finish a perfect 13-0 as they beat Tennessee 42-17. And the word we got.
Congratulations. A decisive win, to say the least, and given that and all of the other circumstances, what are your thoughts tonight on the national championship picture?
Well, I'm very proud of our team. I think we did all we could. We won 13, and that's all we played. And so I'm very proud of these guys. I thought they played a great game.
I don't think there's anybody out there that with a clear conscience can say that Nebraska, and especially Tom Osborn, that great man, doesn't deserve a national championship for this. At least a share.
By late in the evening, national championship votes were in. Michigan was voted number one in the writers' poll. But Nebraska was voted number one in the coaches' poll. Tom Osborn and the Nebraska Cornhuskers had won their third national championship in 4 years.
I think the thing that I will take away from coaching is the relationships, a lot of good memories, a lot of close feeling with the players.
Okay, guys. Okay, Turner.
Great job.
I'm all in.
Hey, no problem.
Okay, thanks. Yeah, great job, Turner. Okay, Danny.
So it was very gratifying to finish it up that way.
Yeah, thank you, guys. You've done a great job for us. Okay, babe. Thank
you. Miss
you. You bet. Give them heck next year, okay?
There's a lot of kids that go through struggles where, have a hard time. And people like Coach Osborn, I mean, it's great to have coaches like that in positions that he was once in. and to say, hey, man, that guy right there is living the life that we're supposed to live. He's letting his light shine. Because everybody watches everybody. Whether you know it or not, someone is watching you, good or bad. And Tom always done good. Whether he wanted to or not, I guess once again, it wasn't his decision, it's just something that's in his heart. And once that light come into a man's life, it's just something that they do. They can't help it. And that's Tom.
To learn more about Coach Osborne, More Than Winning, visit us at PBS Online at the internet address on your screen. Funding for this program was provided by Suzanne and Walter Scott Jr. and Gail and Michael Yanni.